see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying how do you do. They're really saying I love you. I hear babies cry, I watch them grow. And much more than I ever knew. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think
then God
to
said,
myself,
God gave you every plant yielding seed that is on the surface of all the earth, and every tree which is fruit yielding seed, and it shall be food for you. And to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the sky, and to everything that moves on the earth which has life, I have given every green plant for food. And it was so. God saw all that he had made, and behold, it was very good. And there was evening and morning, the sixth day. Then the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great on the earth, and that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. From heaven against all sinful, wicked people who suppress the truth by their wickedness. They know the truth about God because he has made it obvious to them. For ever since the world was created, every people have seen the earth and sky. Through everything God made, they can clearly see his invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature. So they have no excuse for not knowing God. Yes, they knew God, but they wouldn't worship Him as God or even give Him thanks. And they began to think up foolish ideas of what God was like. As a result, their minds became dark and confused. Claiming to be wise, they instead became utter fools. And instead of worshiping the glorious, ever-living God, they worshiped idols made to look like mere people and birds and animals and reptiles. God abandoned them to do whatever shameful things their heart desired. As a result, they did vile and degrading things with each other's bodies. They traded the truth about God for a lie. So they worshipped and served the things God created instead of the Creator Himself, who is worthy of eternal praise. Amen. That is why God abandoned them to turn to their shameful desires. Even the woman turned against the natural way to have sex and instead indulged in sex with each other. And the men, instead of having normal sexual relationships with women, burned with lust for each other. Men did shameful things with other men, and as a result of this sin, they suffered within themselves the penalty they deserved. Since they thought it foolish to acknowledge God, He abandoned them to their foolish thinking and let them do things that should never be done. Their lives became full of every kind of wickedness, sin, greed, hate, envy, murder, quarreling, deception, malicious behavior, and gossip. They are backstabbers, haters of God, insolent, proud, and boastful. They invent new ways of sinning, and they disobey their parents. They refuse to understand, break their promises, are heartless, and have no mercy. They know God's justice requires that those who do these things deserve to die, yet they do them anyway. Worse yet, they encourage others to do them too.
In this video, it is my goal to demonstrate to you that God created a wonderful place for us, filled with amazing gifts, so much beauty, so much to be happy about. And if there's one thing that we as humans have been consistent at, it's corrupting and perverting what God has given us. If you go into your neighborhood, into your community, and ask the people around you, "Are you a good person?" Everyone will say yes. Everyone you talk to believes they're a good person. And yet, we are not living in a good world. We're living in a radically depraved and immensely evil world. And that evil, that depravity, is coming not from one or two individuals. It's coming from each and every single one of us. Jesus made that clear in the Gospels, that there is none who is good, not one. Only God is good. None is righteous, no, not one. Man has a great deal of difficulty accepting his wickedness, his evil. And that is the place where we have to begin. People dream of a utopia, but that utopia is always created in their own purposes, and then they find the need to force others to see things their way. Man cannot create utopia because man is wicked. Man is evil. Man perverts goodness. Man corrupts and twists goodness. Man cannot create goodness. In order for goodness to overtake your life, you need to turn to that which is good. You need to turn to God. At the age of 21, I was an atheist. And some have mocked and said, "Well, what kind of atheist were you if you were changed, if you had turned into a Christian?" I was a true atheist. I found humor in those who had faith, but I certainly didn't hate them, and I didn't spend any of my time thinking about God or debating against Christians and things like that. I was a true atheist. I really honestly couldn't care less. There's a lot of people today that call themselves atheists, but they're not. They have a strong anti-Christian belief and agenda, and they devote rigorous amounts of time and debate and thought and bitterness arguing with Christians. They have some sort of anti-Christian belief system that they're fighting vigorously to uphold, and frankly, that's not atheism. It's your own values, your own beliefs, and it's becoming a religious battle between Christians and these people who assume the title of atheism, but it's truly not atheism at all. As I say, I was a true atheist. I really had no interest in God. I did not grow up in a Christian home. If anything marked my life experience to the age of 21, it was rejection. Rejection by my family and my parents, rejection by my peers at school. To the point that I was really an introverted, withdrawn, fearful person. And all my life I'd always felt that there was something more in life, that I was missing something. I would learn later that that was the prompting that God gives you, leading you on with that thought in the back of your mind that there's something more to life. One morning before work, I was watching television, and a TV preacher came on, and I had this outrageous convulsive reaction. I changed the channel so fast I almost sprained my thumb. And it was such a strong reaction that it made me wonder what was wrong with me. Why was I so afraid of someone so harmless? What could that TV preacher do in my living room when I had the power with a remote control to silence him at will? So I turned back as a personal challenge. I'm not afraid of someone in my own living room. Remember, my life was marked with fear. As soon as I stepped out of my door, I would storm down the streets with a mean look on my face just so people would leave me alone, so enshrouded in fear. I didn't want my refuge, my home, to be another place of fear. So I challenged myself to turn back, and I knew that this man would at some point ask for money, and when he did, that would justify what I had done. He would ask for money, and I would say, that's what it's about right there, is his want for my money, and that's why I turned the channel so quickly. I don't want to be robbed in my own home. So with this sense of self-justification, I changed the channel back and started to listen. And something wonderful happened. I was listening to words that I could agree with, that God is a God of goodness and love, and he created this world for us to enjoy. But something happened along the way. We chose to step outside of the good things that God had given us. We found pleasure in things that were wrong. And I could really agree with a lot of what he said. I didn't find any fault. And the man never asked for money. Now, I didn't fall down on my knees with tears running down my eyes and pray. But I did watch him for the next couple of weeks. Kind of curious to see, you know, everything that you're saying, I feel like I already know it inside me somewhere. And later on, I would come to realize that this too was the power of God. It is only God who can wake you up and make you realize that you are lost in sin and that you do need salvation. And if God breathes into your life, all of a sudden these things start to make sense. And you're like, yes, I was created for a better life than what I'm living. There is more to life than just this. I know it. And it came to the point after 2 weeks of this that he said, if you want to embark on a relationship with Jesus Christ, kneel down and pray this prayer. And he led me through this, what's called a sinner's prayer. But frankly, there's no such thing as the sinner's prayer or a set of words or a ritualistic ceremony that makes you a Christian. Honestly, it's something that happens between you and God. It can only happen if God breathes this life into you and makes you wake up and start to take notice of spiritual matters, a feeling inside of you that, yes, I do believe that God is there, and I do believe that God has a plan for me. And I prayed that prayer, and I said, Jesus, please forgive me of my sins. I repent of being a sinner, of being your enemy, of living in rebellion, of turning to my own pleasure and lust instead of taking care of the good things that you've given me. Please be my Lord and Savior. and I want you to know that something miraculous happened to me that day. In my living room, alone, this TV preacher never said that something would happen. I didn't expect anything to happen. But all at once, a mountain just crashed off of me, and that fear that I carried like a cloak, that like ball and chains all the time with me, fell off all of a sudden. That depression and anxiety that I'd always lived with, just like a mountain, fell off my back. In an instant, so much was fixed inside of me. It would have taken decades of therapy to get to the point that I got to in an instant. And I learned later that this salvation experience is not unique, and it doesn't make me some sort of religious fundamentalist fanatic to talk about it. It's a very natural thing that happens over and over again, has been happening for 2,000 years, and will continue to happen. People all over the planet are becoming born again, their sins forgiven, starting a new life with a relationship with Jesus Christ, their Savior. Maybe you're familiar with the story of the Hebrews being slaves in Egypt, and Moses was God's leader who would go in and lead his people out of Egypt. And God sends a number of plagues on Egypt, and the final one, the angel of death would pass through Egypt and kill the firstborn in each house. There was only one thing the Egyptians or the Hebrews could do to protect their firstborn, and that was to take the blood of a lamb, a first year innocent white lamb, and paint the blood over their doorposts. And as the angel of death passed over, it would see the blood and it would pass over that house. The people inside that house would be safe. Now, did any of the Hebrews go out and look for the blood of a frog or the blood of a horse, because maybe a horse is better, it's better blood, maybe it's more valuable blood, so it certainly would be more protection? No, of course not. They took God at his terms. God said it must be this, and they listened. And would you do anything different? Would you put your faith in the blood of a chicken or a rabbit? No, God made it clear the angel of death is coming. You have one thing that will save you, and that is the blood of a lamb. Likewise, that was a type of what would come. God knew that man in his wicked state would need salvation. And once again, God gave one way that we could be saved. And it was through the blood of Jesus Christ. In him only, there is no path other than that. There is no road other than that. There is no other way. If you want to trust in the blood of goats and chickens and prayers to Gaia and in all these different ways, I'm sorry, but you're gambling with your eternal soul. God of heaven, the creator of the world, gave us one specific way to be safe. When the wrath of God passes over the world in judgment for all the sins of man, there is only one way that you can be saved, and that is the blood of Jesus Christ. That's the only way. Now, this isn't a Western religion. This isn't a Hebrew religion. The Hebrews were God's chosen people to give this message to the world. And the Christian message is universal. It's worldwide. It's in every country. So don't try and say that we only believe this because we're Westerners. That's not the truth. God has given us one way, and that is through his son Jesus Christ. And there is no other salvation experience that will radically change your life. And maybe you're a person who's prayed this prayer but nothing has happened. And you've had people around you encourage you and say, well, you're saved. Don't listen to Satan. He's going to try and make you feel like you're not saved. But you're really saved. Let me tell you this. If you encounter Jesus Christ for real, you will be changed and you will experience it. You cannot be born again and not know it in your heart. And if you haven't experienced that transforming power, then you need to go back to your prayer closet and seek it for real. One woman came to Catherine Booth and said, I've prayed this prayer many times, but nothing has happened. And Catherine Booth gave her wise advice. She said, continue to fast and pray with all your heart and say, Lord, even if you never choose to save me, yet I will follow you, because it is better to follow you than to not. And that night, that woman felt the power of God transform her life. She was born again. Every one of us must seek a real living relationship with Jesus Christ. He is God's plan for salvation. There is no other way. I hope that you'll continue to look to Jesus Christ. I encourage you to go to sermonindex.net. There's some very fine teachings there. The videos of Paul Washer are fantastic lessons. And I hope that this has spoken to your heart and encouraged you that there is a life beyond what we're living now, a life with Jesus Christ. And I hope and pray that God will awaken you the way that He did me.